Well, Kathleen and Denny did a great job of timesharing plants. To learn more about plant partnerships, let's welcome Andrea DeLong-Amaya, Director of Horticulture at the Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center. Andrea, great to see you again.
Hi, great to see you, John Hart.
So tell us about this concept of time-sharing plants. You're not selling me a condo in Orlando, right?
Well, maybe. but in terms of horticulture, it's a really useful tool. So at the Wildflower Center, we're just using native plants. So
sure.
We don't have that luxury of switching out and doing pansies for the winter, for
right.
example. So we're using native plants at different seasons. So
mm-hmm.
we'll have a cool season species that does its thing in the winter and spring.
Right.
When then it goes down, we'll have some warm season species so mm-hmm. that we have something going on all the time.
Okay, so you know, in ecology, that's succession. So that's plant communities changing over time, right? But this is really more about a seasonal approach, right?
Yeah. It's a seasonal succession.
Seasonal succession. So what are the benefits, or you know, why do we want to consider time-sharing plants?
Yeah, I think it's really important so that you don't just have bare dirt.
Yes.
It makes it prettier, green, more green, but also in terms of habitat, you can really maximize the amount of flowers that you can have available for pollinators, for example,
mm-hmm.
or other insects that might be using the plants for other purposes.
So when you're doing this, you're really thinking more in terms of plant communities, not just a singular sort of like you're saying with pansies or something where it's mainly like a feature. You're thinking about something that's changing over time. So does time sharing really, you know, require some plant knowledge? I mean, it seems like you probably want to know a little bit about your plant identification.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, it's good to know what seasons the plants are
right.
actively growing in. So, for example, a classic combination that we use would be wine cups that have evergreen foliage in the wintertime. They bloom gorgeous in the spring,
mm-hmm.
and then they kind of go dormant in the summer, and they
sure.
don't look that great. So then what we do is we can throw some seed down for
mm-hmm.
the annual partridge pea, which is a summer bloomer. It's very fast, and it grows and kind of fills in the bare spots where the wine cup would have been not looking like much.
So with time sharing, you're really also talking a bit more about the herbaceous component than woody
yeah.
species, correct?
Yeah, because woody plants generally have, they have some form, even if they're not evergreen, they still have form to look at. You might still want to have some ground cover underneath them also, so that could apply somewhat there too. But really, I'm thinking more like with the herbaceous layer, where you really, on the off season, there's just nothing there.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, with these species, it's also, this gives you a chance to really kind of, we talked about plant ID, but to probably increase your skills as a gardener, right? Because you're learning, you're not thinking of it more as sort of a static flower bed per se,
right.
but it's more of a dynamic component that's changing and providing you with, you know, some visual cues throughout the year.
Right, it's a lot more entertaining to be able to see, you know, the butterflies or the bees coming at all different times in
right.
a longer period of time. Yeah.
Right. What about, the benefit to wildlife? You know, I mean, time sharing, you know, seems like it's really going to help in terms of habitat potential for your
yeah.
Landscape.
Absolutely, so that you don't have just long periods of time where there's just mulch on the ground. You can have something
right.
that's green and growing. That might be food for caterpillars. It might be, if it's flowering, it might be flowering for pollinators, for example. Yeah.
So what I really like about this too, though, is it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to change out all the time, because some of those dormant materials can provide nesting material for birds or other critters. I know that, you know, some of these also provide overwintering habitat, like we mentioned, for insects, which is really important. But also, what you see above ground really tells you about how healthy your soils are as well. So ensuring that you have different plants in there means that you're really improving that soil.
Sure.
Right.
Yeah, there's more diversity. I think a lot of times when people are gardening, they think they've planted one plant and that they're done.
Right.
But just knowing that there are different things that are happening at different seasons, even
right.
if you don't see what's happening, if it's the roots underground even.
Sure, sure.
Mm-hmm.
So let's talk about a few examples for sun. I know people want to talk about, okay, we've got the concept, we're into this. What are some actual species that you would recommend that you think are great timeshare species?
Yeah, well, I love wine cups, so it's really mm-hmm. helpful to have something like the partridge pea to help with the summer in the wine cups. Another one that I really like for sun is using lantana, because they're actively growing during the warm season, but then they're dormant in the wintertime. So using
right.
something like pink evening primrose is kind of nice, because it's very vigorous and tough and can kind of take its own with the lantana.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you're a little worried about the vigorous nature of the pink evening primrose, you might use something a little softer like Texas bluebonnets or something. That would be growing in the wintertime and then bloom in the spring.
Right, and the pink evening primrose, it can be a little aggressive times.
Yes.
But you can eat it, right?
Yeah, that's right. If it's too much, just rip it out and throw it in your salad.
Well, and with wine cups, I want to be clear too, there's annual and there's that perennial. You're referring to the perennial primarily.
One, yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, mm-hmm. And then what about, we've talked about full sun, shady. I've got a garden, I got big trees or whatever, got a lot of shade, can't grow anything. What are some of my options?
Right. One option that I really like to use is scarlet sage, the tropical mm-hmm. sage. It's so pretty in the summertime.
Absolutely.
Long bloom period,
right.
Great for attracting hummingbirds.
Right.
But it's either an annual to a short-lived perennial. It goes dormant in the wintertime. Mm-hmm. So in a shady spot, I like to put down something like baby blue eyes, which is another winter annual that has beautiful evergreen rosettes in the wintertime. Blooms in early spring, but it's done around the same time that the scarlet sage would start to get going again. And so you always have something going on.
Right, but the scarlet sage, what I think is really nice too, is it tends to reseed itself, at least I see. I mean, it's not something you have to, even though it's an annual, you put it in and then it's done. But I've really noticed that it'll start popping up kind of all over.
And I think that's great for both of those species, baby blue eyes and the scarlet sage will both reseed.
Right.
Yeah, as long as you're not mulching too heavily. Mulch is good, but it'll inhibit germination, so.
Well, let's talk about some more, robust shrubby plants for sun, like Texas lantana might be one there, and then for shade, we've got wax mallow or Turk's cap that are pretty good as well.
Yeah. So for a sunny spot, if you have lantana in the summertime, so it blooms really lovely all summer, and then in the wintertime it goes dormant, and that would be a good time to use something like the pink evening primrose or maybe some Texas bluebonnet. If you have a shadier area, Turk's cap or wax mallow, same plant, two different names.
Yeah.
That's another beautiful, just workhorse in the garden. It looks great in a shady spot, but it goes dormant in the wintertime, so it's good to have something underneath it. One of my favorites is a classic combination that you see in the wild, would be giant spiderwort.
Sure.
And it has a nice kind of evergreen, daylily-like foliage through the winter. Bolts in the spring, blooms really lovely, lots of pollinators, but then it completely melts, in May and disappears.
Right.
And you think, oh, it's all dead,
but
then the wax mallow will be there to take over.
And then with the spider warts, those can spread as well, but the good news is they won't be around for the whole year, like you were saying. And then I found that those are really easy to transplant as well.
Yeah.
So if they're doing really well in some space, and you want them to move over there, it's pretty easy to sort of dig those up and transplant. And then I know with the Turk's cap, again, another edible plant, you can use the flower or even the fruit in salads.
They don't taste like much, but they're pretty.
Right. Well, you got to have a good looking salad
from
time to
time. You can eat the spider warts too.
Right. To plug more into this sort of habitat vein here, I mean, the three big things that we need to have in our gardens are food, shelter, and water. And this time-sharing approach seems to lend itself to really helping us provide two of those main items.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you'll have habitat, the structure of the plants themselves, instead of just having bare space.
Right.
That gives habitat for creatures, and then, of course, food in the flowers or sometimes the fruit will be eaten by different animals, too.
And for gardeners, I think, there's sources like Doug Ptolemy, Nature's Best Hope. There's really a lot of people who are pushing or using your yard as a means to really recapture that habitat that's sort of just really dissolving in the wild, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
And here in Texas, it's important, right, because over 97% of our lands are private. So, this time-sharing concept really allows you to plug into that and provide some of that, again, that dynamic approach, but also providing much-needed habitat for some of these species. I know that people would say, well, where am I going to source this stuff? And you've got an answer for us, because when is the native plant sale occurring this fall?
Right, so come see us at the Wildflower Center. We have our fall plant sale starting at the end of September to the 29th, and it goes for 5 weekends through October 29th, the weekend of that. And the first weekend will be for members only, and then the sale will be open Friday, Saturday, and Sunday from 9 to 1, and we will have a great selection of native plants for people to buy. It'll be really a lot of fun. It also hits right in line with Native Plant Week in October.
Well, that's great. Well, Andrea, I want to thank you so much for coming on set.
It's so fun.
It's been a while. It's great to see you. Now let's check in with Daphne Richards.